Fozzie Bear.
And I'm Gonzo.
And this is Earbuddies. Buddy, you know this already, but let me just tell a brief story to the army here, which is that on Thanksgiving morning at my family's home, we were, you know, sort of milling about waiting for the festivities to begin. And so we turned on the television and opened up Disney Plus and found a holiday staple for me anyway, which is The Muppet Christmas Carol.
When a cold wind blows, it chills you to the bone.
And there's nothing in nature that freezes your heart like years of being alone.
I would say it's the definitive interpretation of the all-important Dickens work.
Oh, absolutely. And how, yeah.
This is not a film podcast, so I'm not going to belabor the point, but just to say it's incredible. And it's incredible because of what else, Matt? The tunes.
The winner would be him. Old Scrooge, he loves his money because he thinks it gives him power. If he became a flavor, you can bet he would be sour.
From the very opening, when all the Muppets are talking behind Scrooge's back about how much of a stinker he is, to all the other beautiful tunes that are shared by Muppets and otherwise in The Muppet Christmas Carol. It's just, I mean, I come back to it almost every year because I love these tunes. I mean, Michael Caine is great. A lot of reasons to love it.
Yes.
But the tunes bring me back over and over again. Tunes written by one Paul Williams, who got a shout out last week in your solo ep, Matt, as a frequent songwriter for the Carpenters.
Yes, well, someone knows how to foreshadow, that's all I'll say.
You're a pro. And so I did what I have done a handful of times since Earbuddies began, Matt. After kind of daydreaming about how fabulous the music is in The Muppet Christmas Carol, the songs by Paul Williams, I did a little Googling. I found his agent, found her email address, and fired one off real quick. Just said, hey, happy Thanksgiving. Wondering if Paul might want to join us for a brief discussion about his career as one of the great songwriters of the 20th century and the 21st century on a little pod called Earbuddies. It was one of those emails that I send, Matt. Again, I've done this every now and then with different towering figures in music. You send it and you don't expect anything back. You send it, you forget it, and you move on with your life. But doggone it, Matt, wouldn't you know it, she said, yeah, Paul would love to talk. How's Friday?
A Thanksgiving miracle. Wow.
What a momentous occasion for the army, Matt.
Yeah, I mean, Tim, it's big. It's big. We want to talk to, well, each other, mostly. That's what this really is about.
Mostly, yes.
But we want to talk to people who care about the tunes, and
yes,
if we could be so lucky, who have done something and maybe shaped the culture in some way because of the tunes. And Paul Williams, man, that's the guy.
That's the guy, man. That's the guy. So we had about a half hour with Paul to talk not only about the tunes, but also his role as an advocate for drug and alcohol recovery and being an advocate for artists' rights. Some really great ground we got to cover here. And so without further ado, let's get into it. Our interview with Paul Williams. Folks, we are really incredibly lucky today to be joined by a very special guest. He is one of the most respected and revered musicians, not just musician. I mean, he's an actor. He's an advocate. He's all kinds of things. He's here with us on Earbuddies. He's won an Oscar. He's won 3 Grammys. He's won 2 Golden Globes. Matt, do you have any of those?
I'm working on it, but not quite.
You're working on it. That's okay. He's in the Songwriters Hall of Fame. He is Paul Williams, and he's joining us on Earbuddies. Paul, thank you for being
here. He's a very grateful, very lucky songwriter is what he is. And Matt, the answer to when he asked you that is just say, not yet. Not yet.
Not yet. That's right.
That little twist of an attitude, of a mindset, is worth a fortune in great experience and opportunity.
Paul, and you know, thinking about experience and opportunity, I mean, Matt and I have this really intense interest in, we talk about the tunes a lot. We love just the craft of writing a great song. We think about it a lot on Earbuddies. And your music is, I mean, it's legendary.
We've only just begun to live, white lace and promises, a kiss for luck and we're on our way.
We've only begun.
And you know, you've got decades on your resume of creating these songs that people, you know, people love and cry over and celebrate and cheer about to this day. How do you think about your own music at this point in your career? When you look back at all the work that you've put on tape, how do you think about it?
You know, the first thing that comes to mind is that they did so well in spite of the fact that they weren't necessarily down the pipeline rock and roll hits. They were just, you know, they're basically, I wrote a lot of codependent anthems, you know, Alex Mommy songs, pick me up and love me because I need it, you know. And I think that there's a huge lesson, you know, to describe what I have, you know, best learned about the process of writing a song and connecting with other people. I'd love to tell you a quick story about my brother. My little brother was named Mentor Williams. He was 6'2". I'm 5'2". He was 6 years younger. He's passed away since then, about in 2016. But he wanted to be a songwriter like his little big brother. Mm-hmm. So I, at the time, was doing really well in like the early 70s. I had an office at A&M Records where I was a contract writer. And my brother came out to join us, and he said he wanted to be a writer like his brother, a songwriter. Got him a little starter deal at A&M Records, a little 6-month deal at A&M Records. And he was writing kind of rock and roll gospel. I thought really good stuff nobody was listening to. And he was listening to the radio. And he'd kind of go, I get it. That's doing. And he was writing and he was listening to the radio. And I'm like, and nothing was happening. Nobody would listen to anything past the second verse. And so he lost his deal. I mean, it was a Saturday, and on Monday he had to clear out his office at A&M Records. A&M Records was on the old Chaplin lot, a great old movie lot. And I had an office there, my writing partner, Roger Nichols, it was the Carpenters, all those people were there. So he's in his office on a Saturday where it's pouring rain, and he's thinking, what am I doing wrong? He's looking out and it's just, you know, he's like, he's depressed, he's confused. He picked up a yellow pad and a pencil and he wrote, day after day I'm more confused. Yet I look for the light in the pouring rain. You know, that's a game I hate to lose. I'm counting on you to carry me. Give me the beat, boys, and free my soul. I want to get lost in your rock and roll and drift away. He wrote what has become a rock and roll anthem. And he wrote it from the center of his chest. And he wrote about who he was at that moment. And people loved it. And I think there's a huge, huge bumper sticker for all of us on, in a way, how to live our lives. You know, if I can, you know, feel like I don't have to pretend to be somebody else. If I don't have to do a lot of drugs and alcohol to pump my ego up to where I can face life. If I can stay in this moment and share what I'm feeling, there's a pretty good chance that other people feel the same thing. I think it's a great way to describe what I've discovered about songwriting is that I was a hit songwriter, have been a hit songwriter in spite of myself. I just, you know, every now and then I try to write that rock and roll anthem that everybody's going to love and it doesn't happen. And then I write something like, I won't last a day without you, and people respond to it. Good story, isn't it?
Yeah. Wow. That's incredible. Yeah. I had no idea. Wow.
That's amazing. And you know, this idea of writing, you know, from your chest, like you said, and, you know, really getting to the core of yourself. Can I ask, you know, I am most, you know, my entry point to your music, Paul, was the Muppets. And,
sure.
I remember being, I think, 10 years old or so and watching the Muppet movie with my family.
Sure.
And being blown away by the Rainbow Connection. And there are so many good songs in that film. But to me, the Rainbow Connection it's this transcendent thing and such a striking way to open what is ostensibly a kid's movie, right? It's Kermit sitting there with his banjo and he is waxing philosophical. Can you talk to me about that?
Well, let's see. You know, first of all, I had just written Most of a Star is Born, and on that I brought in Kenny Asher to write with me. And I loved Kenny Asher's music. I write basically the lyrics, he writes music. We kind of go back and forth a little bit. We write pretty much at the same time, as opposed to me writing lyrics to a finished melody by somebody like I did with Roger Nichols and the Carpenters stuff. Mm-hmm. But so when Jim asked me to first to do Emmett Otter's Jug Band Christmas, first thing we ever did together, and then asked if I'd write the songs for the Muppet movie, the first thing I said was, you know, let me bring Kenny Asher in, because, you know, he writes these beautiful, classy melodies, you know, and you know, you deserve that. Kermit deserves that, you know. So Kenny and I sat down, and it's like, the thing is, when you're writing for a project, like for any film or a stage play the thing is, you want to write songs that do two things. They advance the story, and that the songs that will give you a look into the inner lives of the characters. So we're looking at the lead character. We're looking at the Jimmy Stewart of It's a Wonderful Life. We're looking at Kermit, you know, in the Muppet movie. This is the guy, and he has that kind of energy. I mean, and when things are going nuts around him, he kind of calms things down and looks for a way out that's the most painless. So what are we going to write? What we did first is we said, what's the peak of this kind of song? I mean, where have we heard something like what we're trying to write that is perfect? And the thing that we both turned to each other and said is, When You Wish Upon a Star. When Jiminy Cricket in Pinocchio climbs up into, I don't know if you've seen it or not, yeah. But maybe you have. And if you haven't, there's a wonderful moment when Jiminy Cricket climbs up into the underneath the skylight in the night sky, and he takes off his top hat and he sings, When You Wish Upon a Star. And it's just stunning. And it's like, if that doesn't open your heart, nothing will. It's just, wow. So that's what we wanted to do. And what we did is we did that, what looked like the probably worst opening you could write for a song to sing about the magic, whatever. He lives in the swamp, so he's got water, he's got air, he's got light, he's got refracted light, he's got rainbows. It's the one thing that's mystical that he would have there. So we write the opening two lines that just deny any possible magic in rainbows. Think about it. Why are there so many songs about rainbows and what's on the other side? Rainbows are visions, but only illusions. Rainbows have nothing to hide. And we're like, oh, Jesus, that was brilliant. We just denied any, you know, mysticism, any magic in rainbows. Look what the universe did for us. Because at that moment, what happens is Kermit steps away from the lectern. He walks away and sits, metaphorically sits down with the audience and goes, so we've been told, and some choose to believe it. I know the wrong way to see. Someday we'll find it. The rainbow connection, the lovers, the dreamers, and me. He stops being something that is separate from the audience. He becomes a human being with that hunger and that hope. and is able to sit there and experience the song with the audience. So I think one of the things that, and if it's not anything we did on purpose, it was an accidental gift. It was, you know, no is a gift in my life. And no was just like, no, you're not going to open it the way you thought you're going to open it. You're going to open it like that. And look at the gift you get. All of a sudden, you make Kermit a part of the world that he's speaking for and to. And it's just been marvelous watching the spirit of Jim Henson live on in that song.
That's incredible. I mean, we were very excited to get you on, Paul, because, I mean, for me, Tim, and I, you're probably in the same boat, but I have a pretty short list of just songs that musically and lyrically I think are flawless. And that, what's great about the Rainbow Connection is that, you know, you hear it when you're younger, right? But then I keep coming back to it over and over, and musically and lyrically. Like, you didn't even get to the verse, Who Said That Every Wish, right? Like, that, for me, that's like, it's stunning. It's beautiful. And I love that it was, you know, that Kermit was the vessel through which that was stated.
Well, you speak to something that is actually my philosophy, because I believe the thoughts become things. And so the heart of the song, in what you just talked about, is you know, who said that every wish would be heard and answered if wished on a morning star? Somebody thought of that and someone believed it. Look what it's done so far. Speaks to faith. It speaks to the power of thought, you know, that somebody thought of that, share it with somebody that believed it. And the power of that faith took them to the point where, you know, Orson Welles says, you know, bring it out the standard rich and famous contract, you know. So it's interesting, because the content of the song is pretty much, you know, I think inspired by a spiritual awakening, a spiritual journey. Mm-hmm. And yet the payoff for it is Orson Welles reaching for the standard rich and famous is something that is so, you know, simple and just, I mean, just, it's the essence of the Muppets, is that they managed to in plain frog language and whatever Gonzo is. They managed to say things that spoke to just our very core, I think. And well, that's what I tried to do.
Yeah, that's a really good, because I was going to ask about that. So I know I'm sure you've been asked this probably thousands of times in your life, but, you know, when you are writing for the Muppets, right? Like, I've heard, and you can confirm this or deny it, but, like, you think of them not as puppets, right? I mean, they're how do you think of these beings when you're writing songs for them to perform?
You know, if you spent 2 minutes on the set and Frank walked up with Piggy on his arm, and Jim walked up with Kermit, you'd realize that there were five of you in the conversation, because Frank is the dearest, nicest man, and just a wonderful, gentle spirit, and so is Kermit. I mean, so is Jim. But Kermit, and especially Piggy, will say things to you that would just, wait a minute. I mean, is this little ass going to write a decent tune for me? I mean, it's just, things come out of Piggy that are shocking. It's just shocking. I mean, the level of insult, you know, and I never, ever felt, first of all, when I met Jim, I was already a huge fan. When I showed up on the set of the Muppet Show in England, I mean, I'm walking around like a kid, you know, in a candy store. It's like, for the first time in my life, I felt like I had just joined a gang that had a treehouse, you know, so we're up in the treehouse. There's just silliness and great laughter, and it was the best sandbox I ever played in, and it was just that feeling of just. But the only thing that I ever found that matched it is when I quit drinking. I'm sober 33 years, and when the first time that I sat in a room with a bunch of recovering alcoholics and just went, "Wow, the cravings are gone. Wow, what happened? Wow, this is going to be fun." It's funny, because most people think, oh, recovering alcoholic, that can't be any fun. Trust me, it's great fun. The craziest people in the world were all of a sudden safe to be around. Give me a break. So I talk about that a lot. I tell you know, I there are two things that I'm passionate about. One is recovery, the other one is music creators' rights, and that's a big part of my life right now. And I've never stopped writing. Right now, I'm writing Pan's Labyrinth with Guillermo del Toro for the stage with Gustavo Santaolalla and Jeremy Unger writing the book. It's just, I mean, it's like what a great place to what great way to live my life. It's like we're playing cops and robbers, cowboys and Indians, Muppets and agents. I don't know what the latest would be, but yeah, I love my life. Love my life.
Speaking about these things that you are passionate about, well, Matt and I are both also really interested in kind of what the digital age has meant for musicians. And it has meant some good things and it has meant some really bad things. You know, when you look at the state of music and especially like music consumption, Paul, in 2023, almost 2024 now, you know, what do you see as like the most important thing that you're thinking about on that front?
Well, I work for ASCAP. You knew that?
Yep.
ASCAP is a membership organization, is a performing rights organization. When music is played on radio, on Spotify, when it's sung in bars and bars, there's a performance royalty involved. We're a PRO. We're a performance rights organization. We license the music of everybody from Beyonce and Paul McCartney to the Gershwins. And since 1972, Paul Williams has been feeding his family, putting gas in the car to drive the kids to school with the support of ASCAP. We're over 1 million members. We're like right at 1 million members. We're 114 years old, I believe, 114. But when you think about it, when music is performed, there is a royalty. And the ways that music is delivered has changed through the years. And there have been real challenges and real opportunities at every change. When you went from vinyl, and when you went from three networks a top 40 radio station in every town to just the tsunami of opportunities to go and enjoy content. I don't do content. We do song. We do song scores. We do we you know we make music. We create music. And what you have found in as you entered into the cyber world, and the music streaming especially, that the value of music has not changed, but what we've been paid for it has been grossly under what it deserves. And we work at that. I spent a lot of time in Washington, D.C. ASCAP has been a massive advocate for music creators' rights, and it's getting better and better and better. But with each challenge, you have new opportunities to A, be scared to death and do nothing, or dive in and a classic example right now is AI, is artificial. It's like, because the fact is, I think AI is going to be great for medicine. I think cancer and the like is probably going to get cured a lot quicker with AI. But the fact is, when AI is used to create songs, what they're using is, if so, they have trained the computers on the world's culture, including all of our music. We deserve to be compensated for it. AI, ASCAP has six principles of AI, which basically cover the things that we really need to be protected. We don't need to be regulated. We need to be protected. We want to have the right of consent, the right to say no. We want to have credit on there. We want to have transparency. We want to know when you're using our music to train your computers, and we want to know what's coming out the other end. We want globally, we want the same kind of platform, so we don't have different systems for every country. Let's make this as easy as possible to figure out what's being played, how it's being created, and all, and let songwriters and composers and all use AI as a tool, but we are human first,
Yeah.
One of the interesting things about copyright law is that if a gorilla takes a photograph, a beautiful photograph, it cannot be copyrighted because it was not created by a human. That's good for all of us human
Yeah,
songwriters.
there you go.
Oh,
Yeah.
I did play an orangutan once, but I have no empathy for them and the right to copyright. So,
Fair enough.
but yeah, but it's and there's and the thing is that the staff and the just basically the industry, as I think coming together around this and trying to do exactly what's best to take care of songwriters. But ASCAP is the only not-for-profit performing rights organization in the United States, and I'm just really proud of my association with ASCAP.
Well, you've got our vote. We not too long ago talked about how, I mean, expressing sort of the same concerns about AI and the idea of human creation seemingly being less prioritized these days. So, couldn't agree more with you, Paul.
And I'm told that something like 60% of the people that have created AI are have the same open the door hell concerns that we do. Hell, open the door. Sorry, Dave. I wrote the second verse, and I want part of that.
That's how it's going to end up. Yeah.
We'll work it out when it's like, you as crazy as the world is right now, and all there are times when it just feels, that it feels almost hopeless. How do you straighten out the conflicts right now and get people, what happened to the elegance of kindness? Where has the elegance of kindness gone? And it's still here. There are spectacular, kind people doing amazing work, and the best part of my life is that I've been able to whether it's the staff at ASCAP or Jim Henson, I seem to have found just the best people to work with. Now you guys. Now we're stuck.
Yeah, wow.
On that note, Paul, I think we can add to that list of, I mean, what's making the world better, I think, is the kind of words that you are putting into the world through your music. And we couldn't be more grateful for the stuff you've done, for the art you've created and given us, and certainly for the time you've given all of us at Earbuddies here. Paul, thank you so much.
I really appreciate it. I enjoyed it. Talk again sometime.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Paul.
I enjoyed every bit of that. What the hell? Thanks, Paul.
We'll have to hit you up soon.
Thank you so much.
Hope there's a next time. Thanks, Paul.
Yeah, thank you, Paul.
Holy smokes, bro.
Wow.
This is the mountaintop, man.
This
How don't you love the view?
it's a watershed moment.
Well.
Hey, we're not too cool here. We're not going to pretend that that was just all in a day's work for the Earbuddies army. That
Right.
that's pretty good. That's pretty
Yeah.
good.
Not every day we've got Academy Award winners on Earbuddies. But as he said, Matt, maybe future. You know, we don't want to give up hope. And I've got more hope right now than I've had in a long time. I don't know about you.
You're gonna write that score. That's right. You're gonna go to the Tonys. You're gonna do it all.
I'm gonna do it all. Talk to you later, buddy.
Talk to you later, pal.